Hi, I'm John, and welcome to Edgetone Studios. Today, I'm covering part three of how I built my studio. And when I last left off in the last video, I had just completed the framing, was waiting on drywall mudding. But as we start this up, you'll see there was much more framing to go before the details could be finalized. So let's get started. So while I waited on the drywallers to arrive, I got going on building the angled front and back walls. And part of that required building the diffusers that went at the back of the rear base traps. Now, these were designed to be multiple sizes of 2x lumber, from 2x12s down to 2x8s, and staggered in a certain way. And I was trying to reuse this ancient fir and cedar that we'd saved from the roof of the carport. And I started preparing all these boards by trying to sand them. And then when I found that I couldn't sand them very quickly, I bought a small planer and started planing 50-year-old wood. Well, if you've ever worked with 50-year-old wood, you know that it's pretty damn petrified. And I burned through probably 8 to 10 blade sets just getting this wood. It might have been cheaper to buy new wood, but I really want to reuse what we had. So I was able to build these in the studio to the specifications. And meanwhile, my wife was working on painting the brick on the exterior of the house, a nice dark gray to match with the colors we'd pick for the stucco. And I got those diffusers built and ready to be in place, and they formed the basis of the angled walls at the back of the studio. Now, inside these diffusers, there is insulation on the bottom and then another board with insulation on the top that made them a sealed enclosed space. And from there, I could frame around them and finish the back wall framing. With that in place, I was able to start going on the floors because the front walls had been done. Had these crazy angle cuts around this angled walls, but I managed to get it nice and tight. This was all laminate vinyl, or as they call it, luxury vinyl plank. And then I was able to work further on some of the electrical at the back. This allowed me to get set up for my keyboards that were going to go on each corner of the room. I'd already pre-planned that. At the front, I was pulling all the cabling around there too. So I put in 3 outlets in each corner, and then 8 audio jacks for 4 stereo synths. As well, there were more audio jacks just to the side of the right rear wall. And once that was done, I was able to start on the woodwork. So there's a cloth that went in behind, and then the boards had to be spaced in 1/8 inch, 1/4 inch, 1/2 inch staggered patterns. And there you can see the colors we'd chosen for the cloth. So I got one side wall done right up to the ceiling. And this had to be done in advance of doing the final drop ceiling that was going to be the roof of the studio. And that's because the plans showed the ceiling connecting to the finished wood enclosures. So I got the front done as well. I'd pulled cabling for HDMI for the TV mount at the front of the studio as well. Obviously, I had the other slider in. I'd done that sometime before. And luckily, with the foam underneath the sliders to isolate them, it gave just enough of a gap to slide the luxury vinyl plank under the sliders and make a nice finish edge on the sides. And out front, our mound was growing sunflowers. And then I was finally able to start on the ceiling framing. Now, part of the ceiling required what are called the slot resonators on the ceiling as well. So these were boxes framed around the rafters and then acoustically sealed tight against the drywall. So they were enclosed boxes. Later they'll have insulation put inside them. There you can see the acoustical sealant. I'd pulled more electrical cable for the lights now. This is one of the angled walls in the tracking room. So there was a little corner angled wall on the one side. I was finally able to finish pulling the last of the electrical there. I built the angled wall on the other side of the room. The ceilings were all framed up in the tracking room. They were all framed up in the control room. And then I started on the insulation and covering up the slot resonators in the ceiling and working towards the front of the control room. In the tracking room, I got the light switches pulled in and the HVAC cable pulled into that little angled wall that I'd just built. And as I mentioned in the last video in the series, I had to keep records of all the electrical pulls. So I took a little video of the electrical that was pulled for all the pot lights and coiled up where the pot lights were going to be. So this is the tracking room side. Just gives you a bit of a sense of the framing underneath the drywall and all these runs. I got the HVAC hanging down here and there. As you can see, there's quite a drop between the top drywall ceiling, which is all sealed up, and the lower ceiling that's going to be covered in cloth fabric and insulation in behind. And there you can see the slot resonator boxes that I've built in the tracking room, and just more of the cable. Now here's a shot of the ceiling slot resonators. You can see the insulation in behind there, and note there's an air gap before it hits the insulation, and then it's going to get covered with the cloth, and then the wood will go on top of that. Then I started on the slot resonators at the back of the control room with their strange angles as well. And I had misframed the top of the cavity, so I had to make adjustments to frame it onto the cavity instead of into the cavity. I got more of the ceilings insulated and the slot resonators done. And meanwhile, outside, Tracy had finished painting the brick, and it was a vast difference over what the house used to look like. And then I started on the base traps. Now, these I made with green Sonopan board, which is a perforated fiber board. I attached some cloth strips to each of them using some construction adhesive and some push pins. And to those I glued some Roxel Comfort Board 80, which is a 1-inch thick denser version of the rock wool insulation throughout the studio. I had measured the various sizes for the angled enclosures and cut them to the right length. And once those were all glued up and stacked together, I hung them from some boards that I'd mounted using some eye hooks and zip ties. Then the most interesting product I'd ever ordered showed up, and that was two rolls of 1/16 inch thick sheet lead. This stuff weighed a ton, and half the cost of it was in the shipping. I continued on making base trap after base trap after base trap. There were ones for every one of the four corners of angled walls in the control room. And there's a shot of the hooked over cloth hanging from the eye hook using zip ties. So I was able to get them at the right angle, so none of the sides were touching anything. And Seb continued to help me with this difficult task because it was quite the laborious thing to hold these up and pull the zip ties to the right height and get them aligned properly. But soon they're all placed and you can see them in each of the corners. And then on top of that, filled over with regular Roxel insulation. So out back, the pad had been complete for the entry, and I did all the cedar work around that corner to tie in with the cedar at the back and the cedar at the front. So now all the cedar work was complete. And jumping to audio, I disassembled parts of the snake I'd used for the cable to get all the connectors. And I got the back door installed. This was a mahogany solid core door with heavy duty hinges because there's going to be even more weight on it than the door itself. And now we've hit September. I'm still working away. I rerouted the laundry duct for the dryer, did the only brickwork I did in the whole build. And the HVAC system was now tested and operational, and I got the second slider up with a casing in between. And I got those slot resonators finally finished at the back of the control room and finished all the insulation on the rest of the rooms, all the ceilings. I terminated cable at the front of the control room, just used a simple board to pull the cable through. I got the insulation done in the tracking room. I still had to build those slot resonators. I hadn't put the floor in yet. In the entry, I built these hatches so that the HVAC could be accessed for maintenance. With so much to do, I jumped around to working on the back windows. I built some cloth-covered panels using rigid fiberglass and inserted them into the window frames, and then just trimmed that out with some one-by-pine. That looked fantastic, so I was thinking this is going to look really good. I was really wondering how I was going to finish that space off. I got the dimensions all measured and ordered the window glass for the interior. That's 1-inch glass. Then it was back to flooring, and I was working on the flooring in the tracking room. And as soon as I had enough of that down, I built the slot resonators in the tracking room so that all the woodwork could be completed. You can see I'd only had half the floor down when I finally built those, but I just wanted to get those out of the way because they were so finicky. And out front, Tracy had used the planters to get some tomatoes going. Then I turned to the tracking room door to the hallway and sealed it up. I trimmed up the hatches in the entry and had some latches on there. I finished the data in the closets, which were part of the entry as well. These are going to be storage and the data closet. I got back to the floor and got that finished in the tracking room. So now finally both rooms had full flooring in them. And then I began on the cloth panels. I spent a bit of time figuring out how I was going to do this. And what I ended up doing was tacking the wood pieces into place on the ceiling, stapling them together at the corners, and then pulling them down and fully stapling them before wrapping them with cloth and then stapling the back. And wherever there was going to be an access, such as a light or a vent, I either built a frame around it or put a piece of wood that I could drill through for the light. And you can see that bit by bit, I was doing the control room ceiling, building these complex shapes, filling in around in between the slot resonators. And I used Guilford of Maine fabric. This was the silver papier for the ceiling color. Slowly got it to the point where I had one row of lights working because I wanted to test them as I went along before the panels were up. And continued down the other side. Here's a close-up of the framing, the staples that are holding the wood together on the one side. Usually four, sometimes five or six staples. And then on the back, I'd pull the cloth tight and staple it along. So I'd bought a compression-based stapler for this to make sure I could get this all done quickly. I got the second half of the ceiling going up. Now, since March, we'd been waiting to get somebody to finally come and level the yard and deal with the temporary driveway. And we finally got that work done. I was continuing on with the ceilings in the studio, got the final lights up, the final air ducts, and then lots of the gravel was being hauled away. We were keeping some of it, and the mound was finally flattened and leveled, and we were getting a yard back. And here it is, October. We finally had a full yard. The studio still wasn't complete, but it was starting to look really good on the outside, and I got the planters back in place so that Tracy would be able to garden next year because it was a bit too late this year. Next, I started on the wall panels, and this time the color was an aquamarine from Guilford of Maine, and I got the front of the studio done first, simple three panels instead of the multi panels for the angled ceiling. And because the cuts were simpler, this went quite a bit faster. Okay, here's a video update of what's happening in the studio and where things are at. The build is coming along. Nearly at the point where I can say I'm done, but probably weeks and weeks and weeks away still. Anyways, here's the control room. Got the cloth paneling up on the back wall now. Really makes the slot resonators pop out. Just loving the colors we pick for the cloth panels. All the electrical is done in here. We got lights on all three sections of the ceiling. You can see the slot resonators on the ceiling, the HVAC system. It's coming along great. Need a little bit of trim work around this door. Finish the audio connections and some network cable. This room will be done. Over here in the entry, got bits and pieces complete. We got the vintage lights that I scored for 10 bucks are up. Got some storage cabinets that need some doors. A closet for coats and such that needs doors. A door that doesn't need a door but does need trim. And then over here we have the, what will be the little bathroom. So just a toilet and vanity. Window. As you can see, our front yard is now level. We got rid of all the dirt. Got some garden beds ready for next year. And coming back the other way, see the tracking room itself still needs a lot of work. So all the cloth panels in here need to be done. The flooring is down. And can't really do any electrical till the panels are up. And I'm waiting on glass for the inner windows. And then we got the back hallway. Back door trim needed. Flooring needs to be done. And new stairs and updating that door at the end. And that's about it. Looking forward to actually producing some music someday if I can remember how to play anything. So then it was back to ceiling panels, and in the evenings every once in a while I'd get to sit out in the sun and enjoy a cool, refreshing beverage. But most of the days it was working on these panels all day long, continuing to build piece by piece the ceiling in the tracking room, doing each of the lights as I went. Here's a shot of one of the boards. I'd cut these before I'd put them in the panels, and soon the ceiling was done in the tracking room. And I had Seb helping me some more. I was still waiting for that glass. And I started looking at the stair build, and we found some leftover tile from the laundry room. So we were going to tie that in so that it was a seamless transition. And then the wall panels in the tracking room. And this time we used green natural as the main color with a bit of the aquamarine on the end wall. And it started to look fantastic. Now, we'd already finished painting the entry, so I built the cupboard doors and I covered them with Roxul and some of the leftover cloth to make some dampening in there, because I was going to use this entry as a somewhat ISO booth. And the glass for the back windows arrived, so we got that installed, trimmed it out. The only issue we had was we'd suctioned one into place and found that there were some flies that had gotten in, so we had to carefully pull it open and get the flies out. Then came the first official studio recording day. Sebastian and his girlfriend Katri were recording some music for a wedding, and he brought his laptop up and they used the space to record a song or two. That was a fun day. And the next day, my Roland SVC350 vintage vocoder arrived, so that was a fun day. Next, I got to work on the stairs in the hallway using more of the reclaimed fir. And I'd already got the tiling done sometime in there. I picked up a used 11 rack for a couple $100. I was pretty happy about that. I managed to get it upgraded to the latest firmware. And the custom cabinets for the kitchen area arrived. We had to order a slightly smaller depth of cabinet because it was going to bang into the door to the bathroom. All the flooring had been done in there. I guess I didn't take pictures every day. And we picked up this cabinet for the bathroom. And then I found a local deal on this vintage 1977 Premier drum kit out of the UK, complete with cymbals, all the stands, four toms. It was an amazing deal. We purchased an inexpensive butcher block counter that was in a dark stain, but I accidentally scratched it, so I ended up sanding the top and making it be in a lighter stain, which looked great. And then we found a great deal on a local mid-century modern couch, which was perfect for the listening area. Next up was trim work all around the doors. So the closet door, the front door, above the transom, all around the sliders themselves. I was doing it around the bathroom door. And the drip line for the HVAC was coming into the bathroom at the wrong height. It was going to hit the vanity, so I had to move that down. I put the trim in the control room and began painting everything. Got the window trim in. And because the lights were now working, I could work late into the evening, so I was putting in longer days. And here we are the middle of November, and I'm still working on painting. I'm painting the doors, doing the trim. There's still the hallway floor to go, but the painting's been done in there. The lights are up. I get the floor down. And then I customized this vanity to have an angled side so that it can fit into the space. And I get the stair treads all done up and paint all the baseboards for the hallway. And I got some bathroom tiles at a discount because they were left over from a project. Got those installed and grouted. And then I installed the toilet and the sink and got all the plumbing hooked up. Okay, a short time ago, I got my final inspection approval from North Couchin for the studio. So let's have a tour of where we're at. Coming up to the front door. You enter into Edgetone Studios. And yeah, you hear my neighbor just started up his lawnmower. So I've got the logo on the slider in the entry. It's hard to get back far enough to see it. Put these stripes on there so that people don't walk through the glass doors, because that's a possibility. So in the entryway, we've got a nice little kitchenette area, bar fridge. Gonna just have a coffee maker, some lights above the counter. On the other side of the room, it's a storage closet for coats and such. Nothing in there yet. And then to either side, got storage closets for microphones, cables, hammers, tape measures, things like that. Another on the other side. As you can see, this one holds the data closet, so there's network connections to the various parts of the studio. And off to the side, a little two-piece bath. Nice bright window to let a lot of light in. And as you open the control room door, we enter into the control room. Now you can barely hear the sound of that lawnmower, and it's right beside the house. So here's the control room. Give you a preview around the room. Make you dizzy. Up at the front here, we have data connections going back to the closet. We have HDMI going to the various rooms for video feeds. We've got a TV mount. At the bottom, we've got, it looks like a 16-channel snake, but it's only 4 channels going to the entry, which can be used as an ISO booth. We've got another 28 channels going to that corner. Sorry. The floor there, that corner, and this wall. And that's going to be for keyboards as well as rack effects at the back. And then another 6 headphone cables, 2 of which go to the entry, 6 of which go to, sorry, there's 8, 6 of which go to the studio, to the tracking room, and then 16 channel microphones into the studio itself. Double sliders into the studio. Lots of light in here. And you can hear the sound change as we come in here. That's the super door that leads to the hallway. And some diffusion on the back. Didn't really show the ceiling in the other room, but up here we have overhead microphone stands for room mics and diffusion and absorption at the top. And as we go through the super door, find the hallway. This is a custom bench I made for the back entry, which is right there. And the hallway steps are now complete. That leads up to our laundry room. We don't need to tour the whole house. And then that leads to the backyard, where eventually we'll have a little patio for relaxing in. So now, what's left? Well, probably about 153 different data or solder points to connect. My son and I are going to start on that today. We'll see how many days it takes us. And then I'll start setting up gear. And we'll do some room testing. So excited. It's come out beautiful. And it sounds great in here. Hope to see you someday at Edgetone Studios. Backwards. So I had leftover headphone and microphone jacks from my previous studio that I'd salvaged, plus all the ones I ordered, and Sebastian and I got to work on soldering or desoldering these connections so that we could reuse as many as possible. And then I got to work on soldering everything in the studio. Seb gave me a hand with holding things while I did the ceiling connections. And then I moved on to all the wall jacks. And I built this custom cabinet to go at the back of the room and then started on all the snake endpoints. Here's the completed tracking room. And there's that whack of cables that needed to be terminated. I started putting up some of the vintage synth posters I had and then installing the keyboard racks at the back of the control room. The audio connections there were done. I loaded up the rack with gear that has now changed. I wired the cabling in the entry. And then I tackled these snakes, and I used this little Mackie mixer just to test all the connections once they were hooked up. Meanwhile, I started organizing all my gear, getting it ready to move up. Much of it has been in storage, but some of it was in the basement being used, including the custom desk I'd built in 2019. And a couple days later, I was still at it. I was doing all these quarter-inch jacks. Basically, my entire patch bay setup was quarter-inch jacks to quarter-inch jacks. And I had all these cables to do. And occasionally, I'd take a lunch break and have some nachos and continue on. Phew. Okay, all my audio connections are working throughout the entire studio, all the way back to the runs. And this is how I feel. That really was a good feeling to have those done. My God. So the next day began setup. I brought my speakers up. I mounted the TV. I brought up gear. I spent the day connecting things. I took a few photos. And then next thing you know, everything was set up and I was taking shots of my completed studio. So if you've seen my studio tour, and you've watched these videos through, you've pretty well seen all these things, but there was the finished kitchen. I had my coffee maker in there now. I drink coffee out here every morning. I start my day out here. I had got my vintage synth posters up on the wall. I custom framed those all myself. If you haven't figured out yet, I custom do a lot of stuff. I built my own desk. I built my own patch bay labels. I mounted my own frames for my pictures. I wire my own things. I plan my own layouts. I decide exactly what gear I'm going to use. I'm a bass player, so you'll see my basses lying around. Originally, I had my two amps, but at the front of the room, that's all moved around since then. And back when I originally started, I was on Universal Audio gear with a 500 series rack. I've since switched to Personas. And coming soon will be an even bigger change to my audio setup that I'm pretty excited to talk about in a future video. There's my G&L custom bases, fretless and fretted. I had this external VU meter because I love VU meters. I originally had my alpha bass on my desk so I could play it there. A couple of my other basses hanging up in here. This series of SH-101 ads, which are so cool. The Roland D50 ad on the wall, my Korg SV-1. Obviously, I'm very much into synthesizers and keyboards. I've started drumming now as part of my therapy for my neurological disorder. And that's been really fun to have a drum kit that I can just wail on any time of day and night. The entry looks beautiful. I got to put vintage synth pictures out there. I've got the original plans up on the wall in the entryway or in the hallway. And then these faux Rush album covers, because they came with an order for one of the albums I ordered, or a t-shirt or something. And I thought, well, I don't have any albums to put up there, so let's just put some faux Rush ones. I found these great pillows that match the vibe. My synths have since changed. I no longer have that Jupiter 8, but we finally got a mirror December 11th. There you go. The mirror is finally in place. And that was probably the last official thing to call the studio built. So here it is on the 18th, nearly two complete years later, everything set up, everything working. It turned out wonderfully. I hope that me describing the process and showing how it worked is of use to some of you who are building things. There's a shot of the house when it was all said and done. And come the next June, we finally had gardens growing. And come the next September, we finally got the back patio leveled and patio area made so we can have an area to hang out back. And that's a hangout area for clients, but also for the family. And that's the first shot of the front of my garage without clutter in front of it since we moved in. So that concludes my studio build video series. When I started this channel, I wasn't really planning to do much in the way of YouTube. I really wanted it to be just a way to promote the studio, but I think I will continue to talk about things that I find interesting, that I think other people might find interesting. As I said, I've got a big change coming up for the studio audio setup that I'm pretty excited about. I'm going to do a video series on that. And I'm pretty excited never to have to do a 500 or so picture slideshow video series. The editing in this is just too much work. So the next one should come out a little bit quicker, I think. So thanks for watching. I hope you got something out of it. If you've got any questions or comments about how things were built, I'm happy to answer them. I've also put links to the original studio layout plans in the description if you're interested in the way this design works. You might be able to adapt it for yourself without having to pay for a full consulting or use it as inspiration for something that you're working on. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.